Now is tell me something good. So go ahead and Hunter, mind shutting that door? Thanks. And anyways, tell me something good. What good news is happening in your businesses? Valerie, please kick it off. What do you got?
There you go. Wonderful.
Wonderful, wonderful. Do we have open houses for all of our new listings? So hit Valerie up if you want to do a brand new open house. Yeah, new first on the market. Cool. Who else? Who else? Regina. Nice. Awesome. Yeah, you got that this weekend. And then who's your guest?
So this is Jenny Morales.
Hi, Jenny.
Good morning.
Everybody, welcome, Jenny. Give a round of applause. Guests, raise your hand if this is your first time to today's meeting. All right, go ahead, stand up. Tell us a little about yourself.
I just retired from the Navy.
Oh,
I've been serving for a while in the Navy, but my two older sons, I have three sons. My two older sons are having my third and fourth grandchildren. So even though they're in Miami, they're like, Mom, you need to move. Finally got set up. So saw Sophia at church the other day.
Yay.
Okay. So I'm here.
Welcome. Glad you made it. Thank you for joining the team. All right. I think we have at least one more, right, Tom?
Right here. Go ahead.
My name is Amiguel Rodriguez. I've been a realtor for less than a year. And I work here in Boston.
Awesome. Welcome. The man with the coolest name, second coolest name, Hunter. Awesome. Awesome. Glad you're here. All right. So any other good news is that we want to celebrate, share before we get into today's meeting? Okay.
So just finished a great coaching meeting with Eric Loffel. And my new mantra is my dopamine is my discipline.
Ooh, I like that. Discipline is dopamine. That's strong.
What's your dopamine?
All right. Hey, Steph, I'm going to stop the screen share and I'm going to share my screen. So we do have some fun events coming up. By the way, for those of you who were able to attend the business workshop, was that not fire? Was that incredible? Right. If you want to catch the or get the workbook, just go to brentgove.com and you can download that there. And the reason why I'm here is because we have some upcoming events we want to share with you all. The main one being, if you click right down here on the on Cabo, we have Cabo coming up. So you mentioned you've been to Cabo last year. Was it incredible? Are you going back? All right. So if you haven't gotten your tickets already, it's happening March 4th through 9th. You can go to brentgove.com and register, or cabo24.com. And then also coming up, we have, if you're into networking and toy drives and helping out kids, we have a toy drive coming up December 8th. It starts at 5 o'clock. It's being hosted by myself, Trevor, and a bunch of other great people. So toy drive December 8th, you can just find it on Eventbrite. Just Google Jingle and Mingle. It's the most fun name ever. So yeah. And then some upcoming events or meetings that we have coming. Whoops, let's get that out of there. Y'all don't want to see that. Is next Thursday. So this Thursday we have the incomparable Eric Loffel speaking, but next Thursday I have verbal confirmation that the mayor of Roseville is still planning to attend. So he'll be speaking on the state of real estate in Roseville. So you don't want to miss that if you want to get a photo op with the mayor, Mr. Mayor. And then the week after that, Viral is also supposed to be coming and presenting virtually on the lawsuits that are taking place. So how to hedge your business and prepare, for what's coming down the pipe in 24 with all of that. So we have some fantastic meetings coming up, but right now, Mr. Eric Loffel is the man of the hour. So everybody please welcome to the front of the room. Oh, wait, sorry. Oh, I always do this. JJ, what's happening in the wonderful world of lending?
Yeah.
All right, welcome JJ to the front of the room. That's
guys, nice to see you. I'm JJ Mack, American Pacific Mortgage. And I was just saying, you went to church and all this stuff. I come in here every day or every week. I just feel so welcome. I just want to say, it's so good to see you guys.
We heart you.
Thanksgiving moment. So thank you guys. Appreciate you all. That being said, personal consumption expenditures, the Fed's favorite inflation measure, came down today.
Yay!
That rate's going to keep going down. So we love that. I'm happy about that. They're not going to raise rates right now, so hopefully they at least stay the same or bring it down. They're not going to cut rates, but they are still coming. That being said, I wanted to talk about buying a home right now. And I would, if you guys could, who all here thinks it's a good time to buy a home? Pretty much everybody,
yeah.
Right? So I wanted to share a statistic with you that I read. There was a Money.com article that came out this last week, and they surveyed all of America. But before I do that, I wanted to ask you all a question. Do you guys remember a few weeks back, I was presenting up here, and I told you guys how much credit card debt Americans had?
Mm-hmm.
You guys remember?
Yeah.
$1 trillion.
Wow.
So not a million, not a billion, not 100 million, 100 billion, a trillion. It's a lot. And so Americans right now are in a bad spot. They feel like they just can't get a grip on what's going on. And so if you're hearing people feel that way, if you're feeling that way because you're hearing what Americans are saying, when you're calling and you're making these calls every single day, like you know you should be doing, and they're saying, I'm just not ready, I'm not feeling it, that's why. They're having a tough time with what's going on in this world. Because we came out of COVID, we all had a lot of money, everything was going good, and they wanted to keep spinning that same way. So they racked up this debt, and now they can't pay it off. So I want to share with you a story. But before I do that, that statistic I was talking about, how many Americans, you know, they did this survey, what do you think the American population, how many American population do you think is a good time to buy a home? What do you think?
25%.
25%?
30%. 30?
16%.
Oh, gosh.
And 16% Americans. We all think it's a good time to buy a home. Why don't they think it's a good time to buy a home?
And we're probably the
16%. Yeah. That's it right here. It's us. So, no, we got to do a better job, right? We got to do a better job. When we make our calls every day, you and I could probably sit in this room right now and think of hundreds of reasons why it's a good time to buy a home. They have a couple reasons of why it's not a good time to buy. Mm-hmm. I don't think I can afford it. Interest rates are too high. I don't know what's going to happen in the market. It's serious. You know, they feel this way. They're not going to buy a home. Mm-hmm. How many millionaires are created in real estate? 90% of them. Mm-hmm. How many billions are created in real estate? 100% of them. So we need to share this information with our clients. And that's what we do, right? As realtors and loan officers, we get in front of them and we share with them the good news of buying homes and what that can do for us in the future. And so there's a lot of good programs out there. There's a lot of cool things with in terms of like 2-1 buy downs. We're able to do these right now. We're able to do 1% down on a program that for first time, you know, 38% of buyers right now are first time home buyers.
Wow.
1% down?
1% down.
Hey,
yeah.
Drop the mic.
Yeah.
VA and USDA, you can do 0% down. So there's some cool stuff out there, guys. So when you're talking to your clients, the one thing I want to point out to you today, if you get anything else from me, don't stop the calls every single day. You know who has a ton of leads? This guy right here.
Yeah.
He's got so many freaking leads, and his ISAs call every day. And these are people that are from, you know, years ago, and they're still talking and they're still wanting to buy. So call your databases, get out there, you know, join a team that has the leads to be able to help with that. Get out there and make this happen, because right now, more than any time ever, when we get out of this market, you are going to know they're going to be so thankful for you, because mm-hmm. prices will continue to go up. Any questions I can answer about mortgage or anything in real estate?
What was the thing that just came down? You said it really fast. That the Fed's.
Oh yeah, so core PCE, core personal consumption expenditures. Sorry, I talk fast.
So what is the actual interest rate right now?
So that particular core PCE is at 3.5%. The Fed wants it at 2%, but we're on that trajectory. It is coming down. The actual interest rate itself, when you go out and apply for a mortgage, you're still going to see rates in those, you know, lower 7 percentiles. I was actually able to lock our interest rate for a client. They did pay a little bit of points, but they were at 6.5%. So we are seeing those rates come back in the sixes with some points paid. So, and then if you do a 2-1 buy down, you get a 6.5%. Now you're at 4.5 at the 2-1 buy down. So, you know, there's no reason why someone wouldn't want to buy.
Exactly. And you get the best deals too.
I posted something, I'll share this and I'll leave. But in 1970, if you waited for rates to come down, you would have been waiting until the 1990s.
Wow.
And you know what prices did in that time? it quadrupled.
Yeah.
So yeah. Anyways, get some good stuff to share with your clients. If there's anything I can do for you guys, I appreciate you letting me be here. Give me a call, send me a text.
What's the best way for them to reach out to you, JJ?
Yeah, so it's 916-390-2463.
Hey, JJ, I have a question for you.
Yes, sir.
What's going on, brother? How are you?
Good. Rico, what's up, brother?
How you doing? I'm listening. So the 1%, how high does it go?
So the loan amount wise?
Yeah, how much home can they buy?
So things are changing a little bit on that, but right now you're seeing right around a little over 300,000. So if you're in that market, that first time home buyer market, like 320, 330, you can still qualify and get that 1% down program.
Okay. And then what's the next lowest down payment program from there? Do you have a 2% or anything or?
Yeah. So obviously VA, USDA are 0% down. And then you could also do a CalHAPA loan, which is going to allow you to get your second mortgage on the first. It doesn't have no payment associated with it though. And so a CalHAPA loan, you'd be able to get a 3.5% down payment, but they're going to give you, what is it, Lindsay? 2.5% of that?
It's a 3 to 3.5% minimum. It's conventional or FHA.
3 to 3.5% down.
And then it does have an origination card.
So you can pretty much get your full down payment covered with a CalHAPA loan. You will pay that back.
Get seller to pay the closing costs, right? Get seller to pay the closing costs.
Seller paid closing costs.
So that means literally they could buy a home using VA and CalHAPA or USDA. I know they all have different limits. It depends upon the areas, but roughly about how high is VA with zero down?
Oh, you can go over $1 million.
You can't get anything for that. Just kidding. All right. So that's amazing. And then CalHAPA, how high?
It really depends on the conforming loan amount, which actually just got raised. Yeah. So $766,000.
Wow. So around $750,000.
Yep.
Okay. I like just round numbers. $1 million for VA, $750,000, $750,000 for CalHAPA. And then USDA, talk to me about that. I know those certain areas. Is Lincoln still in there? I know they have different areas. Lincoln used to qualify, but USDA, how high for USDA?
Yeah, so USDA really depends on the debt to income ratio. That one doesn't really have a limit other than that 766. However, Lincoln is, there are certain parts of Lincoln that are still considered it, but it has to be rural Lincoln. It can't be right in the middle of the city anymore.
Right. Ferrari. Yeah. It can't be out there. And okay. So for everyone watching this, you guys, this is what I did at my open house. Is I said, I can help you get this house. With literally, there are programs right now. The government's trying to help you. It's zero down. We'll get the seller to pay the closing costs. You need a decent job and decent credit, being 680 or better FICO. That's what I used to say. What is that fair, or is it 700, or is it 670? Give us the FICO score, kind of the bottom threshold, and then up from there.
Yeah. So CalHAPA, you can actually go as low as 640, even 620 in certain instances. VA, you can go as, I think it's 560, even lower in times.
Mm-hmm. So yep. I would just share that. We have different zero down payment programs. There's three major programs, USDA, government, right? VA, government. CalHAPA, government. So there's three different government programs. They literally help you with your down payment. We'll get the seller to pay your closing costs. All you need is about a $2,000 earnest money deposit, and I can help get you a beautiful home like this. I would do this all the time. And I go, take 1 second and fill out this 5x7. I will call you Monday with your approval. Then I'd fill those out and give them to, my lender, which at one time was David Mack, JJ's dad. JJ was probably 5 years old back then or something. I don't know how old JJ was in kindergarten, but anyways, but now he's a stud and we love him. He's the team leader, but that is a big deal. Everybody wants to buy something for nothing. He made a great point. Story, facts tell, story sell. You know, in the 70s, if you'd been waiting for the interest rates to come down, you would have waited till the 1990s. And prices tripled during that time. So do not wait. And it doesn't matter what people paid for a home 20 or 30 years from now. They're just glad they bought it. So learn to talk to people. When's the best time to plant a tree? 20 years ago. When's the next best time? Today. Put your stake in the ground. Let us help you. And we can help you with your credit. We have programs as low as 540. They're like, what? I go, yeah. And we can help massage your credit, get it where it needs to be. Let me get, in fact, you have a minute. I'm going to get my lender, JJ Mack, on the phone. He is amazing. You got to meet him. Do you have 1 second? I do that open house. I was constantly FaceTiming. Hey, David Mack. Hey, JJ Mack. And I put them on the phone right then and there. And they'd make a connection. Because one thing when you've never met, like, oh, that guy's kind of nice. And then, so you got to be aggressive. And in this market, you better up your game and just bring it. So I love the programs, and I just want to get some clarity around how high they go, what the lower amounts were. And some of you like, well, I don't know exactly where in Lincoln it is. You really don't want to know. What you want to do is get them talking to JJ, say, I can get you a home in Lincoln for zero down. Not all parts of Lincoln, but many parts of Lincoln. And other places like Newcastle and Auburn and El Dorado Hills. A lot of times, El Dorado Hills, yeah. And so we have these low income, high crime rate areas like El Dorado Hills that we help people get in. I'm kidding. That we help people get into homes. So anyways, I'll stop and I'll hand it back over. But I like what you're saying.
Love it.
Appreciate you, man. Thank you.
Quick to add on to that too.
Yeah.
And what Brent is talking about is a heck of a lot different at your open house than, hi, I'm Drew. Do you have an agent? Mm-hmm. Right?
No doubt.
If you're coming into it with, like Brent is saying, upping your game and getting the information that JJ has, or with a different, obviously you go with JJ, but if you're going with that and upping up your, you know, leveling up your game, it's a whole different experience that you're in houses. Then I'm nervous to talk to you. I have a little name tag on it. I know my name. You have an agent, right? With commission, Brad.
Yeah.
Give them some information and show them that you're a professional. They're going to end up wanting to work with you.
Yeah,
100%. All right, Cindy.
Closing in 2 weeks, that is getting into a house in Roseville with $2,000.
There you go. Yeah. So somebody on our team, right? So when you're meeting people at open houses, when you're meeting with buyers, hey, somebody on our team just got somebody into a home in Roseville for only $2,000 out of pocket. If I could do that,
tell the story.
Use it, leverage it.
Question. You mentioned the five by seven card. What do you put on there?
So that's at brentgove.com. Click on buyer, and then click on the mega open house program. There's an example of the 5x7 card. I'd get 10, 15, 20, 30 of those filled out every day. Authorization to pull credit. I go, this is how you get approved for the program. It's exciting. Take a minute, do it. And they go, but I've already got an agent. And then you go, well, Drew, there's no law in the world that says you can't have two. And I promise you, I will outwork your agent. I'm going to turn over every leaf, every rock. Give me a chance and we will absolutely. Yeah, there it is. He's doing it right now. And I said, keep your agent. If your agent finds you a house, please don't call me. Call your agent. And down there, down below, further, is it right there? There it is. It's all ready to go. That's a PDF. You can print them out. It's ready to go. Name, phone number, email, job, years on the job, income, Social Security number, name, phone number, job, number of years in the field, income, Social Security number, signature, fine print, you're above signatures, authorized to pull credit. Man, we fill these things out like candy. Everybody's just trying to get a name and number. I get these. And then you guys, I'll say this. When you get buyers, if you're not calling them every single day, I don't even know what you're doing. You had 24 hours a day. You should be sending them a text, calling them, you know, every single day. That the intensity, the passion, 10, 20, 30, 40 buyers a day. Well, I don't have 10, 20. It's probably because you haven't been doing open houses from 9 to 9 on Saturday and 9 to 9. You can work any half a day and be successful. 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. Go load up with clients. Most people walk around with 2 or 3 or 4 clients and they starve. Get 60, 80, 100. I want you to think bigger. Aim for the stars, land on the moon. You'll have motivated clients. Instead of people like, well, I don't know about the interest rates. I don't know. Prices are high. You'll find people that, I don't care. I want out of the apartment complex. I don't care. I'm tired of renting the house. It's the third house I've been kicked out of. And I just need to have my own place. And those are the clients you want, but you won't find them with 5. If you have 10, using the 80-20 principle, you might have 2. But if you have 40, you'll have 8. And so it is a lead generation problem. Master lead generation. Put your foot, nail that thing down to the floorboard, stitch it down, and master lead generation. You'll have lots of buyers and sellers. So that's good stuff.
Wonderful. Yeah. So excited you're here, Brent. Nice, man. All right. The last guy in the room that I just wanted to briefly mention is Mr. Chad Francis. Chad is a financial advisor. Many of our clients, when they buy homes, they need the next step is for them to build a trust. The next step is for them to plan for retirement. And Chad is an ELP, or what are they calling it now in Ramsey world?
Yeah, they changed the vocabulary on it. It used to be for Dave Ramsey. People were endorsed, endorsed providers in the investment world for whatever reason. Because of the legality behind investing, they didn't want to say the word endorsed because some people were. So they changed it to smart investor.
All right, so he's a smart investor pro endorsed by Mr. Dave Ramsey. If you guys have clients, like what we want to do to keep them working with us, we're not just transactional. We're there to help them in their businesses. Send them to Chad or send them to your preferred financial advisor. So that way we're providing them beyond just the basics of the transaction. Sound good?
Because if we use a second opinion, like, well, I'm not sure about the affordability. What about a free 30-minute coaching call on, let's talk about your budget. Let's talk about what is important for you to make you the shining star and say, hey, you know what? Your agent is right. You actually can't afford this. This makes sense.
And here's why.
Backed by an unbiased third party.
There you go. Love it. Unbiased, but he's biased. Come on. He loves me for more. All right. So those are all the announcements that we have today. The last thing that I just want to touch on is I was watching a video. So raise your hand if you know Frank Crandall. Raise your hand, Frank Crandall. Love that guy. He sends me like a motivational video every day. And the one that he sent me recently was a guy talking about Usain Bolt. He like is the world record sprinter, one of the most successful runners of all time. And Usain trained for 4 years to hit a goal. And so many of us quit after 1 week, 30 days, for lucky 2 months, right? What if we pushed hard for 4 years? And what it all came down to for that world-class athlete was mindset. So that's what Eric's going to talk to us about today. So please welcome to the front of the room, Mr. Eric Lofholm.
All right, well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning. Good morning.
I am always excited to spend some time with you guys. And today we're going to talk about mindset. And I wanted to ask a question and hear from a few of you what your answer is why does mindset matter? So we're going to have this conversation about it. People talk about how important mindset is. Tony Robbins says success is 80% why, 20% how. Anybody have a thought? Why does the mindset matter? Yes.
Because your mind is incredibly powerful. It's more powerful than your body. So if you can get your mind to believe it, there's nothing that's underneath it.
Excellent answer. Who else has a thought? Why does mindset matter?
Mindset is huge because it's defining you. It's defining where you see yourselves, where you're wanting to go. And I've heard something, yeah, from my beautiful team here. Don't listen to you. Don't listen to your thoughts. You need to speak to, you need to speak to yourself. Don't listen to yourself. Speak to yourself. Mindset is true.
Excellent. One more answer. We'll do right here and then we'll hear it. We'll do two more.
I'll say from my sense. Mindset is what you do. Mindset is everything. It's an everyday thing. Mindset is thinking before you speak. Mindset is just the thing that keeps you. Once you have that mindset down, you want to have that discipline and that consistency. And that's where the discipline and consistency comes because you have that mindset down.
Excellent. Steve?
Well, from the book, The Secret, they say what you think about, you bring about. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah.
Simplicity.
Yeah. And in addition to all those great answers, if you think about your mind like a GPS, so you plug in 123 Main Street, Sacramento, California, and your phone is going to tell you exactly how to get there. It's going to be pretty much 99% accurate. So what's above, there's a formula that I'm going to put over here on the whiteboard, and it's reverse engineering results. And so results, and then what's upstream from results is action. And what's upstream from action is thought or language. And then what's upstream from thought or language is being, state of being, the position that we're coming from. So what this is suggesting is the thoughts and the position that we're coming from are driving our actions. Now, I want to take it in a different direction. We'll come back to this. So Tony Robbins says, what motivates us as human beings, does anybody know the things that he says motivates us? gaining pleasure and avoiding
pain.
Okay. NLP says moving towards what you want, moving away from what you don't want. Mm-hmm. Carrot and the stick. Yeah. It's all the same thing. Your brain is designed to take the path of least resistance. So Tom gave me permission to share something that I taught him in our coaching session today that likely are going to transform an area of result in Tom's life that's important to him. And it has to do with an idea of a declaration versus an affirmation. This is a mindset idea that I learned from my coach. And so we all heard of affirmation. And if my affirmation is I'm lean and fit, but I'm eating at McDonald's, I'm not coming from a position of being lean and fit. So we want to become aware of what are we saying, and then what's the position that we're coming from. The position that we're coming from is the state of being. So we can declare something positive, or we can declare something that's not positive. So I was talking to this EXP agent one time, six-figure earner, and he says, Eric, I block out 4 to 5 every day to prospect, but I never do it. And that's a position to come from. So if that's his language, if he's coming from a position of, I block it out, but I never do it, what's the action going to be? He's not going to do it. Mm-hmm. And then he comes to me for coaching and says, Eric, I need some coaching. I go, what's the problem? The problem is I block out the time, but I never do it. I go, that's the problem. That's a declaration. He's declaring it. He's coming from that position. And so Tom and I were having this conversation about he's wanting to work on what he eats after 5 o'clock at night and having discipline. All right. Is there anybody in this room that would like to have more discipline in your life, any area of your life? Okay. I'm going to give you the blueprint. Like what I'm going to tell you right now, this could change your life. All right. Your brain is designed to take the path of least resistance. So Tom's least resistance was not being disciplined in what he ate in the evening. So I want to make it more painful to not be disciplined and to get his brain to be attracted to being disciplined. So if I said to you right now, we're going to do this little field trip and we're going to go over this bridge, and it's, if we jump off it, it's not going to kill us, but it's probably going to be kind of painful on the landing. So we're going to do a little field trip. And one by one, we're going to jump off the bridge. And you're like, yeah, I'm not going to do that, Eric. I go, okay, we're going to change the game. There's a vehicle coming at us at 100 miles an hour. And we either jump off the bridge or we're going to be hit by the vehicle. Mm-hmm. Are we going to jump off the bridge?
Yeah.
Okay. A gruesome example of this, you guys might remember when 9/11 happened, mm-hmm. right? And the planes crashed in the building. And what do people do off the 50th floor?
Jump down.
Think about that. Their brain said, it's less painful to jump 50 stories onto cement than to stay in this building. Okay. So we can harness that idea. And so Tom was sharing with me about his declaration, the position he was coming from, his state of being after 5 o'clock is, I have a hard time following my food plan after 5. That was the essence of it. So he's declaring that. So like you might declare, I'm not good at prospecting. And you're declaring that, you're wondering why you're not doing more prospecting. Or another very common one in EXP is, I want to do agent attraction, but I need to focus on putting food on the table for my family. Mm-hmm. So I need to be doing production. And I'm not in disagreement with that. But if you declare right now, I'm not doing agent attraction because I focus on putting food on the family, how much agent attraction are you going to do? Mm-hmm. You're going to do none. What if you reach out to 5 agents a day for agent attraction? One reach out takes 2 minutes. Send them a text or an email, a direct message on Facebook. Hey, we got this event coming up at PCAR, or I want to invite you to this. And you reached out to 5 agents a day. Do you think if you reach out to 5 agents a day, that that can make a difference in the long haul for your business? Yes or yes? Okay. So in order to create that, what I would suggest, you'd have to come up here to thought and language and state of being. And so who am I being I'm being focused on production with taking out 2% of my day for agent attraction. And that becomes your language. I'm 98% production, I'm 2% agent attraction, or whatever your, however you want to describe it. Could you see how if you change the language from I'm focused on putting food on the table for my family to I'm doing 98% or 95%, do you see how that would make a change?
Yep.
So the one of the key lessons of today is the word declaration. And we're declaring stuff all the time, positive or negative. You're declaring things if you're married or in a committed relationship. You're declaring things about your spouse or significant other. My declaration is my wife is the most important person in my life. So I'm being my wife is the most important person in my life. And that creates a certain set of actions on how I text her and how I communicate with her and the things that I do for her. And that gets generated from that place of I'm declaring that. And I didn't always declare that. So that shifted for me. I was sharing this with Tom in the coaching session that I had this grudge with my father. And so my declaration was he did blank, therefore he needs to apologize. And he wasn't apologizing. So I was coming from a place of resentment. And this is a thought for your notes. There's no wrong thoughts. There's no wrong feelings. There's no wrong thoughts. There's no wrong feelings. So it's not wrong if Tom declares, I have a hard time focusing on my food plan after 5 o'clock at night. And the value of the statement, there's no wrong thoughts, there's no wrong feelings, is it doesn't give you ammunition to beat yourself up. So a common thing in people like us that are success oriented is you'll come to me on a coaching call and you'll say, I'm hard on myself or I'm my harshest critic. Can anybody resonate with that? Mm-hmm. All right. Well, it's not a wrong thought to be hard on yourself, and there's a consequence. So instead of being hard on yourself, I would invite you to be your number one cheerleader as a state of being. If you're being your number one cheerleader, then you're not going to be hard on yourself because that's not what a number one cheerleader would do. And when you're being hard on yourself, you're not loving yourself. So why does that matter? Why does loving yourself matter? Because when you're prospecting for agent attraction or you're prospecting in this market, when it's not the easiest market to prospect in, loving yourself is going to help you. It's going to help you to be powerful and confident. Mm-hmm. Being hard on yourself is not loving yourself. Just me saying that may get you to lose interest in being hard on yourself. And so what do? You start declaring, I'm my number one cheerleader. And you start telling yourself that over and over and over again. I am my number one cheerleader. I am my number one cheerleader. So back to discipline. So Tom and I created this declaration. Discipline is my dopamine, or dopamine is my discipline.
Love that.
And here's what that's saying. So this morning, I drank my coffee from Starbucks. I drank it black. And I normally drink it with a bunch of sugar in it. And so I'm working on mastering my discipline by drinking black coffee, which tastes horrible to me. Tastes horrible. But you know what? When I'm drinking that black coffee, that discipline tastes so good. That discipline tastes better than the sugar. Your brain is designed to take the path of least resistance. If the discipline tastes better than the sugar, what am I naturally now going to do? I'm going to drink the coffee black. So I lead every day with a cold shower. I hate those cold showers. I've never gotten a cold shower that I liked. I absolutely hate them.
Watch what you're declaring.
Well, I got a tool in my tool belt to combat that because I love the discipline of the cold shower more than I hate the cold shower. Because I can stand in front of you and say, I'm a master of discipline. Because this morning I led with the cold shower and I drank my black coffee. And that gives me that discipline. And so Tom is a master of discipline. I mean, this guy, he is amazing. And his results back it up. Whether now he's focused on agent attraction, throughout his career he's focused on production. And now what we're doing is we're just taking a skill set that he already has And now we're just applying it to what eats after 5 o'clock at night. So now it becomes that not snacking on something after 5 o'clock at night becomes the path of least resistance. Drinking that glass of water tastes better than sugar, whatever the case may be. So you start becoming aware of what you're declaring. What are you saying about your marriage? My spouse and I are always arguing. That declaration is not a good declaration. So you start becoming aware. What am I saying about my spouse or significant other? What am I saying about my kids? I declare with my kids, I am unconditional love to my four kids. Well, three of my kids are teenagers. So I get that one tested. So they're doing teenage things. And so if I'm being harsh with them, I'm not being what? I'm not being unconditional love. So that's something for me to work on, being unconditional love. So when they do a teenage thing, they're just being a teenager. But a younger version of me, because I have my son is 21. So I've had teenagers since for the last 8 years. And a younger version of me would blow up at my kids to the point where my son, when he was 16, he moved out. He didn't talk to me for 3 years. And when he talked to me, he called me Eric. Mm-hmm. And one Christmas, when this was going on, I go, hey, I want to get you the new iPhone. And he said, I don't want your iPhone. Mm-hmm. You know your kid's busy. Well, I'll take your new iPhone. And now we're back on good terms. And it just took him some time to go through. But what I didn't understand, because he was my first teenager, I didn't understand that he was just being a teenager. I thought something was wrong. So I came through with force. And then he was getting stronger. He's a mini me, right? Now he's a grown man. But as he got stronger, he's like, oh, really? Well, you taught me how to be strong. I'll show you strong. And he did. And there was a big conflict there. But this right here, state of being. State of being. Noticing your being. Where am I coming? All you have to do to notice your being is just observe your thoughts. So you're doing an open house. Am I being outgoing? Am I being, I'm going to get the contact information? Am I knocking on the doors nearby or whatever it is that you're up to? All right. So we got time for a few more ideas here. And the next question, if we get a little bit of participation, where does your mindset come from? So why do you believe what you believe about yourself? Where does your mindset come from?
Well, it comes from patterns in your life. So every experience that you have forms a pattern of belief, and it's how you feed that belief. So you can either let it be a weed that digs in and roots negative, or you can let it be a seed that empowers you to grow and learn from the experiences that you have.
Yeah, great answer. Anyone else? Yeah.
It does come from my past, but it's also comes from whatever I feed myself into right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, you know, like, so if you're looking for success, I usually, like, you know, Robin, it's like, for me, it's like Grant Cardone, Gary Vaynerchuk.
Yeah.
So
just,
oh, man, 10X.
A lot of times goals, and I set a goal, and then my mindset will 10X. Attract to that goal, and then that's what drives the rest of my life, basically, is to hit that goal.
Yeah. How about did you want to say something?
Well, I was just going to say who you surround yourself or who I'm myself with.
Yeah.
Influences me. Yeah.
How about a mindset like I'm not good enough? Where do you think that mindset comes from?
I think so much of that comes from childhood, honestly. Yeah. And then exactly what you said, which is why I speak up, but what you choose to believe from your childhood and what you choose to tell yourself is not true has a huge impact on your mindset and where you go from that.
Yeah. Do one more answer.
Jesse got all of it.
Yeah.
That's what I was going to say.
What I had on my
say,
what she said. On my notes here is a lot of mindset comes from ages 3 to 7. Yes. You're with your whoever raised you, your guardian, your parents. When we're young, we have these different experiences. And for me, one of my mindsets from when I was a kid is I don't fit in. Mm-hmm. And like so many families, my parents divorced. And so my parents, and I don't know what's going on because I'm just a little kid. And when I was 10, my mom moved. I grew up in the Bay Area, and I was living with my mom, and she moved to Santa Cruz, 2 hours away. And so then one day I'm living with my mom, and then the next day I'm with my dad and my stepmom, and I'm 10 years old. I don't know what's going on. And so I processed that in my brain of I don't fit in. And then that's how it started showing up in my life. And so we can take a look at what are these thoughts? What am I declaring? See, if I declare I don't fit in, I walk in that door into this room being I don't fit in on a subconscious level. Mm-hmm. I don't fit in. I'm not good enough. Fill in the blank, right? So we start looking at what are my thoughts and is that true now, mm-hmm. right? Like, is it true that I'm not good enough? Or is that just something that was in my head back as a survival thing, right?
And that's what happened with your dad. You started that story.
Sure. So I have this coach named Steve Hardison. And he said, Eric, he said, forgiveness is your Achilles heel. Mm-hmm. And so I was being resentful. So being resentful, the problem with that, it's not wrong. And that's where I really love that thought. There's no wrong thoughts. There's no wrong feelings. But there are consequences. Mm-hmm. So the consequences of me being resentful is we haven't celebrated Thanksgiving or Christmas in several years. Mm-hmm. And so I shared with Tom, I actually texted my dad a couple days ago and I said, I want to spend Christmas with you this year. Yeah. So we'll see how that goes. That's me being letting go, being forgiveness, being acknowledgement. And I'll share another one on a personal level. I have an ex-wife, and a lot of times that's not the best relationship between exes. I don't know if any of you have ever experienced that, but that's been my experience. And I sent her an acknowledgement email this week, just this week, acknowledging her for a bunch of different things. And normally I would blast her in an email, or as I more matured, I would just not send the blasted email. I just wouldn't send anything negative, but I wouldn't say anything positive. And I'll read to you guys the text that she sent me. And this was me being acknowledgement with my ex-wife. And, you know, you might have somebody in your life that could be something for you to consider. Here's what she said. She said, oh my goodness, you are so sweet. Thank you. Made me tear up. And it's amazing when we go into this space here, being loving, forgiveness, acknowledgement, kind.
For you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. So I wanted to talk about a couple mindsets, starting with prospecting. And I wanted to first explore what are some mindsets around prospecting that have consequences. And it could be how you think or just in general how a real estate agent might think. But what would be a mindset that would have a consequence around prospecting?
I'll say rejection.
Mm-hmm. When I prospect, I might feel rejected, which might cause me to not prospect, right? There's a fear. Yeah.
I have one every single day. I used to be super shy. People can't believe that. No, but I literally did not get off the kindergarten bus. I was so shy when I was saying it was like crippling.
Yeah.
And my parents just helped me work through that. And then at a certain age, I realized, oh, I'm going to miss out on life. Like my mom used to say, you walk into your room shy, everybody else is thinking about themselves. Like they're not even thinking about you. They're in their own. So don't worry about anybody else. So anyway, I had some great coaching from my parents, But every time I pick the phone up, I still have to fight. Isn't that crazy? Fight that thought. And I love talking to people. I mean, I'm actually a people person.
Yeah.
But that little.
So what's the thought?
I suppose it would be you don't know what to say. Or they don't want you or something like that. Probably I really like dialed it in.
Yeah.
But over the years, you just learn like, that's a lie. I'm not even. That is not who I am.
Yeah.
But it's so funny how when you step into something new, that old thought will train, or that old mindset is pretty cool. So
yeah. Thanks for sharing.
Yeah.
Anyone else have a thought that has a consequence for prospecting.
I'll get to it.
I'll get to it. Right? Or I know I need to do it, but I never do it.
Mm-hmm.
Or I just don't prospect.
Time.
I don't like prospecting. I don't have the time to prospect. I'm busy doing other things. I'm too busy to prospect. Those have consequences. So let's talk about some positive thoughts around prospecting. What could you say? Instead of those things, what could you say?
I'm a prospecting machine.
I'm a prospecting machine. Excellent. What else could you say? Yes.
I love prospecting, so I do it every day.
I love prospecting, so I do it every day. Excellent.
If I don't prospect, it will cost me X number of dollars.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. Another one is just to think about it as a priority. You know, you look at what you need to get done in the day, and we do our priorities. Whatever our priorities are, that's what we're going to do. So those are some really good ones. Now, who's in control of the thoughts in your mind?
Me.
That's right. We all are. So what my coach taught me was, if I have two dogs and one dog is, I know I need to prospect, but I don't do it. That's the name of the dog. I know I need to prospect, but I don't do it. And the other dog is called, I'm a prospecting machine. Those are the two dogs. So the question is, which dog grows? The one you feed. The one you feed. So you're in control of your thought. So as I was coaching Tom today, Tom can declare, I struggle with what I eat after 5 o'clock, and that becomes his reality. Tom can declare, dopamine is my discipline. And he gets to decide. And he might decide one day, I have a hard time with what I eat after 5. And the other day he decides dopamine is my discipline. Like this morning I chose to drink my coffee without the sugar. We'll see what I choose tomorrow. It's a choice. Sometimes we shift, but sometimes we have setbacks in our own thinking. So start becoming aware of what you're saying and how is what you're saying creating. What is that creating in the world when you're talking about referrals? I never get referrals. Here's a very common one that comes up in coaching. I'm inconsistent. I want you to think about that. As a state of being and as a declaration, I am inconsistent. How is that going to create? You're going to show up inconsistent. I am consistent. I am massive action. And that's how I show up every day. You know, if you ever get some one-on-one time with Brent, ask him what some of his thinking is. His thinking around action, when he's talking about going caveman, right? He's talking about accessing, it's like mama bear, but that's Brent's version of mama bear, okay? We have it inside of us, okay? So he knows how to like snap your fingers and pull it on command. And another thing about Brent, what does Brent do in relation to personal development?
He invests all the time.
He's sitting in the front row, always, always taking notes, always getting better. I don't know another human being on the planet that works more on his personal development than him. That's a little insight to model that. Model it with the podcast and with the personal development, with this meeting and doing the things to put the thoughts in your mind so you can be the best version of yourself. Because you pull up, like for me, when I went from this, my dad's got to apologize, to I'm being forgiven, that one thought, it shifts. And that's true for all of us. So this is a market that it can be really great to really step up your consistency.
Yeah. Real quick, okay, talking about the market, I hear of a lot of agents that choose to have negative statements about the market. But then I also hear a lot of agents that have positive affirmations about how much opportunity there is right now. Can you share about that?
Well, let me promote this again. This is my cell phone. I'm doing EXP prospecting training every Wednesday at noon. And these sessions are recorded. And this would be a really good thing for you to go back and just listen to all the recordings. You don't have to watch, just listen to it and you'll hear my mindset about prospecting. It doesn't cost you a penny. If you text me, I will text you the Zoom link that we meet. It's live every Wednesday. And I'll text you the recordings. It's just like a big old list of like 20 recordings. And you can go and like Netflix and binge listen to it. And you can get my best ideas about prospecting. So Don Peach, you guys know Don?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Don is like one of my most consistent people showing up for that call live. So on a day before Thanksgiving, that Wednesday, week ago, whatever it was, he did 250 outreaches. And he got a listing appointment that I think was yesterday. And I think it produced 3 leads. And so here's Don in this market day before Thanksgiving. But he wasn't saying, you know, you're looking to buy or sell a house. It was a happy Thanksgiving thing. But then they came to him and were like, hey, I need your help. You can ask him about that, what actually happened. It was, well, you can hear it on yesterday's recording. Just listen, go zip it to the end and listen to Don talk about that. That's all created out of mindset. Because if he's of the mindset that, you know, it's a tough market, blah, 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 he probably isn't doing that. And would you agree probably most agents weren't prospecting the Wednesday before Thanksgiving?
Right.
Right. Nothing wrong with that. You're doing family stuff. Most people aren't working that day anyway, but he was. And he's got some really hot stuff going on right now.
Just to let you know, this is a fallacy that we agents get into. Most people were working that day.
Yes.
Just not most real estate agents.
Right.
Because McDonald's still had all of their employees come in. And Sears still had, well, Sears did. But you get the idea.
Yeah.
There was a hell of a lot of people that were working.
Yeah.
Just not real estate agents and possibly loan officers. They all took a break, right?
Yeah.
We're the only people that chose to do it. One other point before we shut up here is that I believe I set an appointment for every 2 hours I spend prospecting.
Yeah.
That's pretty consistent over decades. And it almost doesn't matter what kind of prospecting it is. If you spend 2 hours on the phone, you're going to set an appointment. And if you're trying to back into some goals, I think that's a good round number for me. I see you, Mac, JJ's nodding his head. I think it's a good number. And so just plan on it. If you'll spend 2 hours a day prospecting, you'll set an appointment every day.
Yeah.
So, well, yeah. And if you guys go off of those numbers, too, that Barry's talking about, and you do the numbers game that we talked about a few weeks ago, right? If you do an appointment a day, right. For every lead, every 7 leads, you'll get 1 escrow. So if you can do that every single day, in fact, you can go do 4 deals in a month just based off of the consistency.
And as a new agent, you probably should be thinking, and actually, as any agent, you probably should be thinking 4 hours of prospecting. And if your pipeline's too full to let you get there, great. But, you know, 4 hours is probably a good target.
Excellent. Well, on that note, we're pretty much top of the hour, so it's going to wrap our meeting. It was great to be with you guys. I want to acknowledge everybody for showing up today. Have a great rest of your day. Look forward to next time we connect.
All right. Bye online. Have a good week.